Johnny Rotten was the most infamous man in Britain.
I am an anti-coaster. I am an anarchoaster. Don't know why.
He was the face of the Sex Pistols, purveyors of chaos who spat in the face of the establishment. In the apoplectic words of one critic, the greatest threat to British youth since Hitler. The Pistols imploded in January 1978 at their final gig in San Francisco, and Rotten's farewell message to the crowd was predictably withering.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated?
But Rotten was to re-emerge a few months later under his real name, John Lydon. He bemused many of his followers with his new defiantly experimental band, Public Image Limited. Lydon recently announced Pill were reforming after nearly two decades. And ever since my teens, this is me back in those distant days, he's been one of my real heroes. Not just a pop star, but a poet and prophet, up there with Blake or Rambo.
I always remember when this came out. It's Metal Box by Pill. It's their legendary album, 1979. I'd just turned 18, and I went out and bought a copy of it, and it struck me as a kind of weird, almost like an archaeological relic. It's something that's designed to feel as if it's somehow been dug up. And now that it's gone all rusty, it really does feel like that. Part of the challenge of the album, apart from it being an oral challenge, was just getting the damn thing open without breaking your fingernails. But then, actually, playing the album posed its own separate problem. Because I put it on, and I started listening to it. I thought, my God! What is this extraordinary noise? I remember when I first put it, my girlfriend immediately left the room. Everybody I lived with left. They said, you can't listen to this. And I was thinking, this is so profound. Can you look, the guy who made Anarchy in the UK, this is where he's moved to in just 2 years. He's a genius. This is astonishing. And then a friend of mine said, you do know you're playing it at the wrong speed.
Oh, I'm very uncomfortable. They've got me on a drum stool. I'm not used to sitting up.
I like the fact we've got these trains going overhead. And somehow they're quite pale as well.
It's London, isn't it? You know, here we are, swanking it with the big knobs. It's grim up north, but it's grim down south too. Don't forget it.
So, John, why now?
You said this wasn't going to be hard. Why now? Well, why not? Many reasons. I mean, it's obvious, really, to me, but maybe not to you, that I've been working fairly consistently hard over the years. I'm surprised that it's taken so long for me to get Pill back on the road. But it is so expensive to just restart, and it, 'cause everything is from scratch all over again. But it'd be well worth it. Be a complete orgasm of a performance. And I hate to keep saying this, but, you know, Country Life Butter, the money did help. I buy Country Life because I think it tastes the best.
What does Pill mean to you as opposed to what the Pistols meant to you?
Oddly enough, it's freer. I can get into, like, emotions, you know, in a much deeper way. I can cry my eyes out in half of these songs and usually end up doing exactly that because they're from the heart and soul. Well, the Sex Pistols is an act of aggression, really, against oppression. It was a very, very good start, I would think, for anyone that wanted to enter the wonderful world of pop music. So be just, you know, go on. There you go. You look like a saucy young bugger. Have some fun, and I did. I think I did well with the Pistols, but I've never written a song in it that I don't believe in. And I took that and advanced that a couple of stages further in Pill. Pill is the experimental side of me, but it's also the more truer and honest. I deal with a lot of real personal issues and personal pain in public image, and the Sex Pistols really isn't a format for that.
No, I always thought, the Sex Pistols was the first music that, pop music, that I really loved. I mean, really thought, wow, I can throw all that other stuff I've been pretending to like away.
10cc.
Exactly. You could probably, yeah, my whole record collection, it was, oh, thank God, that can just go now.
I was there at the right time.
You certainly were.
And nobody else was, so, ha.
I was just, before we came to do this interview, I was opening up Metal Box. And I remember...
You've managed to get it open?
I can barely get it open. I was just stunned by how the sort of the distance that you travelled from Anarchy in the UK to that.
For me, that was no great leap. I mean, even in the Pistols, in the darkest days towards the end of the first breakup, should we say, I was writing songs like Religion. But I knew the band... the Pistols really couldn't get to grips with a song like that, and it just wasn't working. And, you know, Sid, God bless his soul, there's no way he could get around a bass line. So for me, it wasn't an enormous leap. It was a gradual progression into things, or degression, according to your lack of taste. Religion has caused the most serious harm to the world as we know it. Definitely history is riddled with it. I should know. I've got an A-level in history. I'd like to see it eliminated.
You pray to the Holy Ghost when you sack your host. Do you read who's dead in the Irish Post? Do you give away the cash you can't have?
So that's a song that many people tell me frightens them. And I remember earlier reviews said, don't play with the lights off. I remember that one review. I agreed. It does, it sends chills down the spine. But when I'm writing it, it seemed kind of corny, but I went ahead with it anyway, because sometimes I can be corny, but it's actually the most genuine root core to the problem.
Were you taken to church when you were a kid?
Yeah, the Catholic Church was a constant scene of terror, and Catholic school. But my parents soon learned the ways around and out of that. You know, when as soon as any kind of illness would come in. I mean, in particular, my mother's slow, torturous, cancerous death. The priests, they wouldn't come to the hospital to give last rites or anything unless money was delivered to them, and it shouldn't have been that way. She got very upset with that because she was quite seriously religious up to that point. And then, things lingered on a few more months, and she asked me to write a song, and I did, and it was called Deaf Disco. And I don't know what I felt about playing it to her, but she totally loved it. And that's a glorious combination of pain, agony, and Swan Lake put together. And that's my mum's death knell. father died last year. And of course, I started playing Def Disco again, and the agony all just started up all over. And so, you know, I flippantly say the country life butter helps no end, but the real, true reason for reforming is I really need to deal with these emotional agonies in a really proper, serious way. And public image is the only way I have of doing that. And I've never understood death. I've never appreciated it or wanted it. I don't know where people go, but I miss them, sadly.
Lydon came from a close Irish family who lived in a small council flat in Finsbury Park, North London. Surprisingly, the young Lydon was actually more of a swot than a tearaway.
You once said you were a product of the British self-education system.
Yeah.
How did that work?
Well, I advanced myself, didn't I? I took every exam that was ever available. I really, really enjoyed it too. I found education not to be a thing to, like, turn your nose up at and sneer at, but to be an absolute release. But then I always loved books. When I was very, very young, I could read and write before I went to school. My mum always got me interested in that. And it was a difficult time, the first year in primary school, because it was in Eden Grove off Holloway Road, and it was run by nuns, and I was left-handed. And they were still practicing that ridiculously old-fashioned belief that left-handed was a sign of the devil. So they would constantly be caning my knuckles with the flat, sharp side of the ruler to get me to write right-handed.
That's amazing. I was left-handed and I went to school and I had the same...
You've got the same thing. Unbelievable what they can put kids through, isn't it? Is the modern system any better or different? I don't know, but you should never do that to young kids. In many ways, though, it kind of made me what I am.
Gonna say.
Yeah, no, it's my approach to life is to make the best of what it is, and don't be wallowing in, oh, woe is me. And then meningitis came along, and that weren't no great fun, because that put me in a coma. And that took me something like 4 years to properly fully remember who I actually was. So it's starting all over again.
How old were you when you got it?
I was seven. And not until really 10, 11 did I find out really, you know, what I was missing. God, it hurts, because you know you're missing something.
What did you lost? Your memory?
Yeah. So you don't really know they're your parents. You know that they told you they are. So it's like you're vacationing in a really squalid house. And you're sure the big one at the end of the road's the one you really belong in.
That sounds like a Pearl song already.
It is, really.
But are you saying that you kind of died to yourself?
Yeah, really. And you know it's there, but you can't find it. And I suppose it was a good process, really, was it's kind to be cruel, was what the nurses recommended to my mum and dad, was to just shout at me, to make me angry. And by anger, I'd start to remember things, much more so than if it was mollycoddling me.
Bloody hell. So, yeah,
so I was professionally dejected for love. Made for a smashing life.
Sorry, I shouldn't laugh.
You should, because it's funny. Life is funny.
I want to know what the first books that you remember reading, say, in your teens, what were you reading?
Oh, God, always the Dickens things, because they have such a great way into them, a brilliant way of writing. Shakespeare, I just took to, like, automatic. I just love the... it's not verbose, it's that I wanted to know what it actually meant, not in the way the schools were teaching it, because I loved the Laurence Olivier, Richard III thing. Oh, magnificent film.
Now is the winter of our discontent, made glorious summer by this son of York.
Anyway, the way in school they were teaching it was that they missed the point. And what I, because I'd, we'd moved around a bit with my dad's work, and we'd stayed in Norfolk when I was young, and it left an impression in my mind too, you know, that ooh, ar, right? And so I started reading Shakespeare in a kind of a Norfolk accent, and I got it all of a sudden, like, out, brief candle, life is but a walking shadow. Conspiring with him, out a Lord and bless it. It makes sense. You get the poetic beat, and then you get the rhythm of the time and how people spoke then. And then it's not confusing posh language. It's rural for then.
Mm. Well, it's very raw language, isn't it?
Very raw, very, very descriptive, very beautiful, and very savage too.
And Lydon has witnessed more savagery than your average pop star. He might have tried to reinvent himself with Pill, but Lydon has always been haunted by the notoriety of his alter ego, Johnny Rotten. In 1980, he even spent a few nights in jail after a fracas in an Irish pub.
Well, you could call it jail. I call it vacationing in Mountjoy in Dublin. That was only a miss, that one. I won on the appeal. I was accused of assaulting two policemen's fists with my face. And in fact, that particular incident is what led to me going in and recording the Flowers of Romance album. And I was just so eager to get back into a studio and express my anger and contempt at being so wrongly accused. And I didn't even wait for the band to turn up. So most of Flowers of Romance is just me bashing around in an empty studio. I did well. I got binoculars on top of Box Hill. I could be Nero, fly the eagle, stop all over again. I can't depend on me so-called friend.
By the early 80s, Lydon felt increasingly he could no longer live in Britain. He was subjected to repeated police raids. Start all over
again. It was relentless and continual and just did not stop. Just twice a week, raided wherever I'd be, smash everything up and have a good laugh at my expense. I'd had enough of that. No, I didn't like turn tail and run. I just found it really kind of futile. We couldn't get any venues or gigs as Pill at that time in England. So we just kind of sort of sauntered off to New York, rented a very cheap apartment, and would just travel off in a transit van to Pennsylvania one night, New Jersey the next, go up and down the coast.
Lydon's lived in the US for the last 25 years, and the move pushed public image away from the avant-garde towards a more pop-friendly sound.
How would the culture show like a rise?
Pill even had a major hit with Rise in 1986. But lurking within this smoother sound, you'll still find lyrics that explode like bombs.
In the song Rise, there's a line in that called Anger is an Energy.
Yep, it is. By God, I'm clever.
Is that a credo? I mean, that seems to me...
Yes, if anything, it's in opposition to violence, which I don't ever think solves anything, ultimately. This is when, Gandhi has always impressed me with that idea of passive resistance. What a marvellous scheme to come up with, and it did work. It worked.
In the Sex Pistol days, you were associated with violence, or people thought perhaps that you were violent, but as far as I understand...
Blame the objects of derision.
weren't you more beaten up, as it were, than beating?
And I don't know. I'd never admit to that. But I was definitely attacked more than I did any attacking. My words are my bullets. Right? Those are my best weapons, and I best stick by them, and always usually do. This is a world destruction.
Whatever style of music Lydon turns his hand to, his vocals remain raw and untamed. A virtue Lydon doesn't hear in much of today's pop music.
You can hear no end of electronic trickery on many, many vocals now on records. And that just like, at first it amused me, now it just really outright offends me because it's so fake, it's so wrong. You're listening to Toy Town Robots. I'm not auto-tuned. I don't have an auto-tuner. When I hit a bum note, it's deliberately... I hope. Sometimes it's not. But it is what it is. And you gotta live by it. And you gotta sink or swim by it. As long as I keep rigid to my sense of values, if I believe in any rigidity in life at all, my sense of values and the honesty of the song therein, I cannot go wrong. My ears are not closed, not to no one ever. And so you're constantly aware of other approaches to things. It's very, very useful to keep an open mind.
Do you ever listen to classical music? I mean, as in Stockhausen and people like that? Is that part of your...
Yes, Mozart, love. Just God, Requiem. That's my favourite, I think, piece of music, along with a few other pieces, but Requiem by Mozart is just stunning. Stunning piece of work. And that's apparently unfinished. Well, you know, do you have to wait till you die before you get the finale? it's terrifically powerful stuff.
While Lydon cuddles up to Wolfgang Amadeus, it seems every band and musician of the last 30 years have been listening to him. He's one of the few artists to have shaped both rock and dance music.
I'm not being a big head. I'd love to be. But I'm not, but I have almost continuously influenced the shape and format of modern music, and that sometimes to my detriment.
Have you ever been annoyed by it? I mean, have you
sometimes.
Ever sort of listened to Oasis sometimes. Singing and thinking, hang on, that bloke's well, no, singing that, just like me?
Yeah, well, that struck me at first as quite nice. I thought the song, was it Rockstar? Oh, hang on. But I kind of see the fun in it, and it's all right. I mean, well done. It took me, what, nearly 30 years to get that kind of singing acceptable.
Lydon is nothing if not unpredictable. He horrified many an old punk when he appeared on I'm a Celebrity. At the age of 53, he seems to delight in growing old disgracefully.
Do you think it's harder for someone like you to grow old than it was for, say, someone in Picasso's line of work? I mean, do you think the music business is particularly tough to get older in?
I've no concept of that at all. I've never thought about it. Pete Townsend wrote that ridiculous line, hope I die before I get old. I mean, I've told him many a time, aren't you sorry now? All right? It's this love of youth and youth only. I mean, you know, getting while they're young, by all means, but I don't mean perpetually stay young. It's teen years, it's almost like a state of ultimate stupidity, really. You can make the most vital mistakes in your life at that point. I don't know how, but I think I did really quite well, and I trotted through the teen years and came out, you know, waving great big flags and shouting and screaming. Unfortunately, a lot of people have followed them flags. Rather than appreciate what I've done, they end up trying to imitate or utterly, completely dismiss. And both of those causes are wrong.
But you were only 19 when you... Wasn't that right? You were 19 when you were in the Sex Pistols? 18, 19, 18, yeah. Boy, yeah.
I often thought 17, because it was such a bad memory.
But if you met Johnny Rotten coming down the street today, what would you say to him?
Well, a concept to meet yourself. I almost did once at the Rock Circus when they did that wax dummy of me. Whatever you think you are, you ain't. You ain't. These ears shocked me.
What are you fucking...
And this nose, like a ski slope. Oh. And then the teeth. Hey! I was a hell of a lot uglier than I thought. And I had no good body image beforehand. It tell you what it does, it wipes away conceit and ego. You know, you just, well, my God, I've got by so far looking like that. Nobody seems to have noticed. Doing well.
Doing very well. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Oh, made a road rise, and your enemies always be behind you. Life's grim. Well, we'll make it better.